Okay, good morning. Welcome back. Today is Thursday, August 11, 2022. Class 17, Weibu Saya Da and Buddhist Practice, or Anapanasati. Concluding the third chapter of the second part of the book, The Essential Practice, Chapter 3, Happiness That Ever Grows. I'm going to complete this chapter today and possibly complete the series today. See how we go. This is the middle of the dialogue in this chapter between Weibu Saya Da and Uba Khin, who became a very important teacher and meditation center sponsor or founder. In the decades after this dialogue. And it's an interesting thing, just from a dialogue just now in class, the phrase came to mind, beating a dead horse, meaning futile continued focus on a matter that actually has been essentially resolved. There's a little bit of that in Weibu Saya Da's approach about just make effort, just practice tirelessly without rest, just go straight. It's easy. Anyone can do it. You can do it. Do it now. Do it now. Don't rest. Don't wait. Do it now. That just doesn't work nearly always, or that's true. It's, yeah, well, you know, I mean, I've spoken about this, so, you know, there's, in this series, we're talking about Weibu Saya Da as a arhat, and I think that's right, as a teacher, and the nature of the teaching, and the nature of, or the teaching, and then the suitability of that teaching for us today. And absolutely, it's a very simple, streamlined, straightforward, direct teaching. There's no fault with the teaching whatsoever, and I don't see any fault with the teacher either. Meaning I think he's an arhat. But we really are not in an age where very few people will be able to do what he's recommending, or have the singleness of purpose that, and the access to will. So very much we're talking about Iddhipada here, the four bases of power, the four padas of Iddhi. And I want to talk about one of them today also, if I can get myself to finish this chapter, the Iddhipada of Citta, or Chit, which is sometimes translated as mind, or thoughts, or heart, or mind state, or disposition. Sometimes it will indeed be that we can use his teaching perfectly, or for a short period of time, and throw away everything else, or realize that indeed, coming to complete and perfect awakening and release and freedom, the happiness that never ends, is the most important thing in life. And I want nothing else. We can believe or recognize it's the most important thing, or what's better, right? What's better? There's nothing better than Nibbana. There's nothing better than return to source. There's nothing better than perfection of the seven chakras in terms of good, bad experience. There's nothing better than the bliss that never ends, or the deathless, or Satchit Ananda, the bliss of Satchit. There's nothing better than that. But it's really true that we want things that are not that high. We want the temporary and the impermanent and the greater, you know, we want Sukha Dukkha rather than this Sukha Sukha without Dukkha. Okay. And a lot of people fool themselves, and a lot of teachers fool their students, and a lot of teachers fool themselves, New Age types for particularly, presuming that they only want the final goal, when their actions show otherwise, or believing themselves to want the holy, confusing the fact that they recognize the sincere one that's not trying to fool anyone, the teacher who pretends to be an arhat when he's not, those who claim themselves wise, as some who discuss Apollonius may understand, not that, but even the sincere of us who know intellectually that there's no better experience than final freedom from stress and suffering and delusion and reincarnation. There's nothing better than that. If you want good, bad, happy, sad, that's pure sukha sukha, no dukkha there, or pure well-being. But actually, our chanda is mixed, our intention and our will is, our will to that is not supreme, as was Gautama's, as was Webu Sayadaw's will to the singleness of intention, chanda. His virya was maximal, and his chanda was perfectly single-minded, or single-focused, or perfectly focused on only the highest. And chitta, or chit of mind, was bright and clear, and fully in harmony with that single intention, able to deploy maximal will. And thus they attained. But we're not there. That's just not where we're at. And saying that it should be, it must be, why can't you do it, falls on deaf ears is a little bit like beating a dead horse. So, and then as I alluded but didn't explain, the most sincere seekers who intellectually know, quote, there's nothing better than final moksha, don't necessarily admit to themselves that they want lesser sukha, or sukha that is sukha dukkha, such as intimacy with a partner, such as physical wealth, or at least comfortable material surroundings. Those who have singleness of intention and deploy maximal will, and the mind, chitta, is fully set upon the attainment of the single goal of complete perfect enlightenment release, they don't care about material circumstances. Hell no. They'll sit until they die. They'll sit and they do work without resting. Yeah, of course. But we should simply acknowledge when we're not there, or where we are really right now. And as I say many, many times, you can't get over there until you finish here. So you've got to finish being here to be somewhere else. And finishing being here really means know yourself, accept yourself, deeply knowing, deeply accepting, deeply understanding, making peace with what indeed I am right now. Where I am now is how the condition of this chitta, this mind right now. And this may not seem like a big deal for some people, but it's a big deal for some others who do really appreciate what the deathless is all about, even if we're not there, and have had spiritual penetration. And yet, we have to accept that we are okay taking it a little slower. So, anyway, the dialogue goes on. Middle of the chapter, Webu Sayadaw is asking Ubakin about the awareness necessary for practice. Going up a little, Ubakin says, yes, we have to work, disciples. If I practice this awareness a lot, meaning the awareness of the five skandhas as impermanent, or doing mindfulness meditation and focused awareness, if I practice this awareness a lot, then I don't want to miss this happiness that derives from it. Isn't it possible to practice this all the time? It is possible, sir, says Ubakin. This is very good. Will it diminish, meaning the happiness? No, sir, it won't. Is it tiresome to keep up this awareness? It isn't tiresome. The awareness of the spot or mindfulness. Is it tiresome? It is tiresome. That's why people can't meditate 24 hours a day. So there's some kind of spiritual bypassing here. I don't. I mean, you'll see some more of it. Will you use up material goods you've saved up? No, sir. You won't. What about your work? Will it be disturbed? It won't be disturbed. Well, if you can, he's saying you don't need to also do. You can do meditation while you're working or be focused in attentiveness. What? At the spot of the watch your breathing while you're driving your truck? I'm not sure about that. I don't think so, actually. So there are some kind of, he's a monk who threw everything away because he doesn't want anything but complete and perfect awakening. I think that he's just underestimating the fact that people are too distorted to put his teaching into practice. So he goes on, will the others know about our practice? They won't notice, sir, says Ubaikin, but actually they would. And one of several points of what seem to be unstated or non-discussed points of conflict here, Weibo Sanyo says, oh, the others won't notice? And then he says, yes, when we have the teachings of the Buddha and he practiced them continuously, when we're able to focus our mind on the object, we won't get tired, will we? We won't, sir. And this is how the Burmese schools teach, and this is what I talked about. There's one school where they basically do 2, 3, 4 hour sittings. And if you're screaming in agony, that's your problem. You stay there or you leave. And it's very harsh, even more than it's they're more Zen than Sasaki Hiroshi. And if it works for you, great. It's just people do damage by forcing will, or the will is to force intention, the enforcing the singleness of intention when it just isn't there. So some people will disagree, but frankly, you can hurt yourself by forcing practice. So anyway, Weibo Sayadaw Moore says, well, yes, when we have the teachings of the Buddha and practice them continuously, when we're able to focus our mind on the object, we won't get tired, will we? We won't, sir. We won't spend anything, our work won't be disrupted, and others won't even notice, meaning it won't bother people. You receive the teachings in no time, and then you say to yourself, now I shall follow these teachings. When you have this volition, the iddhipada there, chanda, this intention, I think is his the word he's intending, or the root. When you have this intention or volition and put forth effort, then the virya iddhipada factor will arise, meaning will or energy or power, and you will arrive at the goal in no time. If you take up the practice now, will your progress be slow or fast? And he wants the answer to be, he wants the student to say, it'll be fast. But actually, Ubakin says, according to circumstances, sir, sometimes it will be slow, sometimes no. There's a lot of times when Weibo Sanyadaw here has the translator put exclamation marks after Weibo Sanyadaw's statements. And that just shows that, there's a conflict in play here, I think. Anyway, asking if progress will be slow or fast if you take up the practice now, Ubakin, I think, reasonably says, according to circumstances, sir, sometimes it'll be slow, sometimes gets cut off, and Weibo Sanyadaw says, no, wait, yes, sir, never mind about this. And actually, he keeps changing tack as Ubakin keeps disagreeing with him. It's a little strange. So Weibo Sanyadaw says, never mind about this. If I focus my attention according to the teachings and keep it with the awareness of respiration, breath, isn't this much possible? It is possible, sir. Is this quick or slow? It is quick, sir. You see, if you establish effort, the virya iddhipada, meaning energy, virya's will factor arises. True, of course. Can you say how quick this is? Yes, sir. Have you put your attention there and does it stay? Yes, sir. As I decide to put it there, it stays, doesn't it? It does. So if it stays, you've reached happiness. very simplified. I mean, this is why one reason he didn't become a big teacher in the West. It doesn't work for most people. I mean, it's fine. He's a holy man, but you reach happiness when you're just sitting watching breath. Well, if you're in eternal happiness, then you'll never need to get out of meditation. But actually, people feel tired, and stuff comes up called psychopathology or distortion leavings. But he says, if it stays, you've reached happiness. And there's also the truth that, yeah, when you're in real mindfulness, there is no stuff arising, actually. When the concentration on the on breath, let's say, as object of concentration, is steady and the mind goes to equanimity, there is happiness, there is great well-being. So if it stays, you've reached happiness. Are you able to speak as quickly as this happiness is able to arise? I'm not, sir. It's easy to achieve happiness if you want it. Yes, sir. So Ubekin just keeps agreeing with him because that's the best way to handle this. It's easy to achieve happiness if you want it. Well, in reality, for most people, it isn't. Meanwhile, if you go straight in this way, you can't. But most people can't go straight in this way. And therefore, it's not easy to achieve happiness. It's easy to achieve happiness if one's intention is single-focused, one's will is aroused, one's mind is bright and undivided. Yes. And that's why I often say that the final breakthrough is a matter of getting in range, getting in target range, getting in range of the target as moksha or the deathless nibbana. And that's like getting to higher self. Getting to higher self is getting in range of final attainment. Jnana is the first step. And so get to higher self, which I think is close to non-returner, or is non-returner in the four attainments in Buddhism. Attaining sixth density, attaining higher self, attaining jnana, self-realization or realization of non-duality to some degree or unity. This puts one in range of nibbana, of source of return. Then, yes, it's easy. And that's easy to achieve happiness, the final happiness, when you're in range. It's getting to be in range that's the challenge. And so, Wei Bu Sayadaw says, this is the highest sort of skillfulness, the skillfulness of achieving happiness if you want it. Do you hear? This is the highest, the highest. It's, I think he's frustrated actually here, that the people around him can't attain the Nibbana that he knows. This is the highest, the highest. Only if you have past merits can you be born as a human being and receive the Buddha Dhamma. This type of skillfulness, upaya, cannot be put in numbers. Do you understand? Then the six qualities of the Dhamma are there, the qualities of the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. When the Buddha taught this, the people understood. Among the six qualities of the Dhamma, akaliko is one, isn't it? What does akaliko mean? Immediateness, immediacy. And Wei Bu Sayadaw goes on, akaliko, immediateness, means that as soon as you fix your attention, the results come. So, if you establish effort with intelligence, the results come so quickly that you can't say they're quicker than they come. Or you can't even think that fast. Is it so? If you establish awareness now, meaning awareness of the spot, the attentiveness, non-grasping attentiveness, attentive mindfulness, attentiveness. If you establish this awareness now, if you keep it here with your effort, happiness arises in the very same moment. This is immediate. Who would have to question this anymore? And Ubekin says, who would have to doubt his own experience? And Wei Bu Sayadaw replies, yes, when happiness has arisen, there's no looking for it anymore. The answer comes by itself, doesn't it? It doesn't take any time. All of you are bright people, and you've understood the teachings of the wise and compassionate Buddha while still young, even before the words of instruction were complete. But though you understand, at times your mind will think as it pleases, but let us practice. What happens in the mind when we plan to acquire when we plan to practice to acquire merit, quote, I'll perform merits later on. Now I have to do this quickly, meaning one postpones, he's saying. Hold on. I've lost my place in this massive page. Just a moment. So he's talking about the mind that postpones. I'll perform merit later on. Now I have to do this other thing quickly. Doesn't this happen to you? It does, says Obakin. Is it good to think and speak like this? No, sir. And when you make efforts and the virya idipada factor has arisen, what's the right thing to do? The right thing to do is to practice. And this is also a good point, is make hay when the sun shines. We won't be able to live like Weibo Sayadaw, but there will be times when we want to go straight or stop moving. Go straight or be still. There's two different ways of saying it. Meditation or keeping awareness on the spot is not quite going anywhere. It's actually stopping and stilling and focusing and holding fast to the intention of single-pointed concentration. And that makes the light of mind brighter. That affects the field of chitta. And that is a great thing and does bring happiness or well-being and power. So he goes on, and so there are certain things. When this will has been arisen, the will to attain, one ought to practice, of course, certainly. And Weibo Sayadaw says, yes, if you want to become happier and happier, you have to put forth effort as soon as you've received the instructions of the Buddha and have accepted them. Then the virya idipada factor will arise. When you make use of this factor, will, energy, power, that arises in a split second, does it get consumed? It doesn't. Does it diminish? It doesn't. You may decide that the happiness you've got was quite sufficient for now and the future, and you say, I don't want to progress. Can you practice and not progress? One will progress. If you practice not just for a short time, but longer, will you achieve only as much as you get out of a short period of practice? One will get more. So the more you practice, the better. The longer, you know, the better. The more, the longer, the better, of course. And the key to practice is just doing practice. You may not like what happens, meaning you feel pain in the body or lots of thought in the mind, but just the follow-through of sitting through the pain, even if you need to scratch your leg or move, change posture or whatever, or the mind is very hard to settle down and lots of thoughts, any practice is good practice, and any is better than none, actually. I mean, but there's a right time. There's certain things, you know. Your house is burning. It might be better to take care of what you can preserve. So he says you'll get more out of a longer than a short period. And Weibo returns, this is good, disciple. He's talking to you, disciple. This is possible because we are now in an auspicious era. I don't think that's true at all. Because we're born into the right form of existence, yes, and because we make right effort, yes. The energetic get the true answer even without asking others. Very good. Do you hear? Isn't this so? It is so. So, even if we live with this happiness all the time, it won't diminish, it won't be used up. And what happens if one doesn't want to progress? It isn't possible not to progress, sir. Way beside us says, yes. If you aspire to this, there must be many different troubles. Is it possible to attain Bodhi or not? It is possible. It's possible now and in the future. So let us say, I don't want to progress, and then focus our minds. Is this possible? It isn't possible not to progress if we work. Okay. Do we achieve greater happiness the more we work? Yes, we do, sir. So I don't know what this was about. Either you want or you don't want. The problem is people want and don't want, actually. And so when we want, we do practice, and when we don't, because we want other things. You know, I just think, although what he says is blameless, the reality is that nearly nobody who listens will do what he's saying. And we can say, yes, sir, but in fact, we don't live what he says, so we can say, yes, sir, but, you know, I'm not as I'm not as single-pointed and focused as you are. You are ready to finish the path, and I'm not. I don't know. I mean, you're in range, and I'm not. Or I'm approaching to getting in range, but you're in range, and you've now finished. So Weibo Sayadaw says, we can attain buddhi awakening, but and we can also choose the time and place of birth. We can then choose a good existence as we wish. When you attain the happiness you desire, what else do you need? Nothing else, sir. You don't need anything. You just have to choose. Is choosing tiresome? It isn't, sir. You can drop at any time. There are four stages to Nibbana. It's interesting. I think he sort of teaches his... He doesn't dialogue very well with people. He's not really dialoguing. He's just saying, here's the mountaintop. Get here. You can drop at any time. There are four stages to Nibbana. Is it possible only for certain types of Aryas, meaning noble ones, those who've attained one of the four stages? Do we have to choose the state of Nibbana? No. What about the place? It isn't necessary. Yes, all by yourself, without any help? It's possible. I'm not sure what he's driving at. He's really saying whatever, wherever you are, whoever you are, however you are, the goal is in reach. And in a crowd, if you go outside the pagoda, it won't be possible, I think. It's easy, isn't it? The Buddha, the all-compassionate and omniscient, taught many humans, devas and brahmas, the knowledge he had attained through penetrating the truth himself. These beings, full of confidence after receiving the teachings, were able to fulfill their aspirations. 2,500 years ago, in a high sattvic era, in a time of high sattva, now we are in the not sattva yuga or a pure yuga. This is a very degenerate condition around us today. He goes on, as you establish awareness, you should establish continuous effort. There are many different types of people. Some are good at reciting or reading or preaching or explaining. I have no doubt about you, disciples. With whomever you compete, you will win. Yes, sir. Okay. And he says, yes, though they are victorious in their talk, will they achieve anything if they don't practice? No. So what's the difficulty? Talking is tiresome, isn't it? All we have to do is to make efforts to bring to fruition the aspirations we've made and work as the wise of old did. Understanding that, we have to take up this work, our minds will be focused. You're very busy. You may say, we'll practice later, when we're free. Does this thought come up still? It does. Sometimes the mind is like that. But I think you don't actually say so. Maybe, sir. You even speak your mind? We do. It's very monologic here. It's even though it's a dialogue, and this is probably something about Burmese culture and Burmese Buddhism and the teachers of Burmese. They basically hand out pronouncements. They don't really kind of dialogue too much. This dialogue is basically, I'm telling you the truth, and you agree with what I'm saying, don't you? Or here it is, right. And when I ask you a question, I'm intending you to go it a certain way. Which is fine, I guess, but I didn't realize that. And that's Burmese Buddhism, Burmese Theravada, Vipassana places have that kind of teacher-focused or I don't know if I'd call it authoritarian, but you could. But presumably, you know, we were talking about awakened teachers. But it's a sort of authoritarian style. It's sort of teacher authority centered. He's just basically saying, here's the story, don't you agree? And if I ask you a question, there are right answers. And the right answers are what I'm trying to get you to understand. And when you get it, then you should be free of doubt and just go practice, and that's it. Except it just doesn't work that way, because the mind of people is more confused than this approach seems to indicate. So he says, you see, many times they're having a conflict here. He says, talking is tiresome. Does this thought come up, this thought that we'll practice later when we're free, meaning when we're available, does this thought come up still? It does. And Weibu Sayadaw says, sometimes the mind is like that, meaning we postpone or we think we can't. But I think you don't actually say so. Maybe, sir. You even speak your mind, meaning you even say, this is getting all very tangled, actually. You say, not just think, we'll practice later when we're free. You even speak your mind? We do. And Weibu replies, well, if you want to say this, never mind. And then he ends that line where it didn't go where he thought it would go. It says, but for the future, can't you burn these impurities out? You do have the teachings of the Buddha, and when this happens to you, i.e. you want to procrastinate, get rid of doubts. Strive to get the answers without asking others. If you focus right now, won't you get them immediately? Isn't this possible? Yes, it's possible, sir. Is it possible to focus as you sit here? Yes, sir, it is. Is it possible to maintain the happiness you achieve in this way also when you're standing up? Yes, sir. And when you walk, it's possible then. And when you carry out all your many responsibilities, yes, it's also possible. You see, it's always possible. And this is the answer he wanted. And this style does seek that. It's a little bit like Socratic method. It seems a bit heavy-handed to me. Frankly, I'm just too much of a louse or whatever, but it seems a little heavy-handed. Meanwhile, Weibu Sayadaw is an arhat. Yes, yes. You know. But you see, in the end, everybody, this is why people choose different teachers. People choose teachers that they have most affection and affinity for. Some people love Trungpa Rinpoche despite countless issues in the community. Some people love Ramana Maharshi and just don't have a feeling for Nityananda. Some people thought that Muktananda's successors were the cat's meow. Some people have affinity to different teachers. And while that doesn't guarantee that that teacher is capable, it just sort of gives, I think, a sense of go with the one you want. And if you find out they're a scoundrel, then you've learned something and you have more discernment than when you started. Otherwise, you get something useful from them, that's great. Don't assume that some other teacher doesn't have something great too. And be willing to change if you need to. But take the teacher and their teaching as far as you can. But not every teacher appeals to everybody. And some people will naturally, I would more comfortably sit with Chuangsu and drink wine than sit with Weibu Sayadaw and see how I'm inferior in terms of chanda and virya, how my idipada is inadequate. Which is true. Absolutely, my idipada or the idipada of this one here is inadequate to attain as he attained, as he's encouraging all to attain. And, okay, fine. So it's a certain approach with a certain mindset that works better with certain students that is of a certain culture too, you know. So it's useful to see what's on offer. So he said, going on, it's always possible to have that awareness or to strive and maintain attentiveness. And Weibu Sayadaw says, what ability do you need? There's nothing difficult in it. Or is it difficult? And Ubaquin, in a very subtle way, answers, once one has acquired proficiency in this, then it isn't difficult anymore. That's true. If you don't have proficiency, it's difficult. And that's what Weibo Sayadaw doesn't seem to want to admit. And Weibo Sayadaw, seeming to address other disciples other than Ubaquin, with whom he's dialoguing, says, quote, he says that it's not possible after all to simply focus here. That's not what he said. He said, once one's acquired proficiency in this, in the practice, then it's not difficult. And Weibo Sayadaw, seeming to be irritated, possibly, it's an interesting final chapter here in the book because it really shows the limits of this teaching style and the dynamics of the interaction between Ubaquin, who perhaps, was still gunning to become a teacher in his own right, but he does disagree rightly with Weibo Sayadaw when it seems to be needed. Weibo Sayadaw, it's basically saying it's not difficult, it's easy, it's easy, it's easy, it's not difficult, just do it. That's not quite true. It's just not quite true. It can be when one has acquired proficiency or when one's intention is single-minded. So Ubaquin says, once one's acquired proficiency in this, it isn't difficult anymore. Weibo Sayadaw seems to be irritated and says, he says that it's not possible after all to simply focus here. That's not what he said. Just put your attention here. That's all. Well, isn't that easy? And Ubaquin says, yes, it is easy. And that's true. Just putting your attention on the spot is easy. But keeping it there is not. And Weibo Sayadaw says, it's ever so easy. The Buddha is incomparable. He accumulated virtues without ever resting. He completed his parami on his own, working for the welfare of all. Didn't he? Yes, he did. And because he could complete them, it is easy for us now, isn't it? It is easy. How is it today? You have to raise yourself happily and complete your work, and then, in accordance with your aspirations, you simply take the bliss you desire. Just take it. It's ever so easy. This is interesting. It's ever so easy. Or is it beating a dead horse? Don't be modest. Don't allow yourselves to think this is not possible for me. This is not suitable for me. This is not proper for us. This is not for me. Aim at what you desire. You will get it. Isn't it so? Yes, it is, sir. And so while I'm, could be called critical, or you can say, yeah, I'm being critical, he's absolutely right on this too. It's not, I would never say it's easy. Never, never. But it is also true that thinking is not possible for me. It's not suitable for me, it's not proper for us, it's not for me, is not true or it's harmful and it's not beneficial and it's wrong. It is possible for us, it is suitable, it is proper, it is for you. If you want it, when you want it, it's possible, it's proper, it's suitable, it is for all of us. Period. Now, make your decision and do whatever you want to do. But it is possible, it is suitable, it is proper, and it is for us. And so when he says, aim at what you desire, yeah, make sure you know what you desire. And, if you have lesser desires, it's up to you. You can struggle, or you can aim higher. With a higher, seeking to fulfill a higher level, longer fulfilling consequence being of longer fulfillment desire. But he's saying, aim at what you desire, you'll get it. And that's, he's like a motivational teacher. While indeed I'd never say it's ever so easy, simply take the bliss you desire. He didn't just take the bliss he desired, actually. He practiced very hard for many years. For sure, it wasn't easy, but it is simple, and it is not. It is harmful to think enlightenment's not for me. Awakening's not suitable. It's not proper. It's not appropriate. It's not the right time. Do what you want. You can if you will it. You can if you will it. He goes on. In the times of the Buddha too, Humans, devas, and brahmas came to the Buddha, worshipped him, and after they received his teachings, they achieved everything. They completed all their different aspirations, didn't they? They did. Isn't it possible to fulfill your aspiration by establishing unwavering effort while you are a king? Can you count the names of the kings who've attained complete understanding of the Dhamma? They're without number, sir. Really? I wonder. He goes on. Many wealthy people made efforts and attained understanding while continuing their work and business, didn't they? They did. Is this possible? It is, sir. Can you count such wealthy people in numbers? No, sir. What about people who were neither kings nor rich people? They are innumerable. Didn't all those who received the teachings and followed them assiduously fulfill their wishes? They did. And you see, there are four levels of attainment. You know, Sotapanna comes much earlier than Arahant, right? First level. Sotapanna is within reach. It's a big deal, but it is within reach. We are in range of Sotapanna. Again, Ajahn Chah, I think, said anyone who follows Patimokkha, the rules, and does intensive, you know, prolonged practice at his temple, his forest Wat, I don't know, Ubon, Ratchathani or something, Ubon, I think it was, in the north, should attain Sotapanna in a year. And I think that's absolutely the case. And so that is in range. Nibbana may not be in range, but Sotapanna is. And then some of us are sixth density wanderers, so it's a little, you know, got to make some adjustment there too. It just means that the next attainment is in range, even if the final is not. That's a very important matter. And to say, it's not proper, it's not suitable, it's not for me, I'm too much of a schmuck, I can't do it, that's not true, that's harmful, it's false. If you will it, you know, if you will it, you get it. But that is, should not lead to any kind of self-harm, obviously. So, he asks, didn't all those who received the teachings and followed them assiduously fulfill their wishes? They did. Wei Busayada replies, humans and devas, all of them, lay disciple. A lot of exclamation marks. What about now, lay disciple? The period of time is the same. No, wrong. The occasion is the same. No, the Buddha doesn't walk in the world now. The plane of existence is the same. Yes, Kamaloka. If we simply establish our effort and take the teachings, do we still have to choose certain times to practice? There's no need for that. Really? That's correct, sir. Yes, the time and the form of existence is right. Meaning, the time for practice and the human rebirth, the state of being a human right now, form of existence, is suitable for attainment, for sure. You can achieve your aspirations at the time you wish to, can't you? That's right, sir. Yes. Do you understand? Before, they didn't practice because they were busy. How is it with this, quote, I'll practice when I'm free? Do we still have to set times like this? It's not necessary to set aside certain times. So he's saying, don't postpone, don't procrastinate, just do it. But actually, our period of time is not exactly the same as Gautama's, and the occasion is not the same because you don't have a Sangha today like you had 2,500 years ago at all. But it's still doable, of course. But yes, it's a degenerated age, absolutely. But it's still possible. And so he said, what happens if we practice only when we're free? If we stop the practice, how could you practice when you're not free? If you stop the practice, then we won't attain what we ought to attain. But now we get these jobs done, and what else? We also fulfill our aspirations. We get two things done at the same time, meaning do your worldly job and practice. Don't we, lay disciples? What's better, to get one thing done or to get two things done at the same time? It's better to get two things done, sir. So you see, it's worth keeping yourself busy. But even though I say that it's working, keeping yourself busy, don't start to enjoy simply being busy. If you want to realize the teachings, don't just keep running all the time. If you establish effort at the same time, the virya idipada factor will arise, establishing effort while holding awareness or attentiveness. Make yourselves firm in this. If you say that you want to do this work, but still distract yourselves here and there, your progress will be slow. But if you establish this awareness and keep it up happily, I don't know if you can happily go to attainment, but I just, you know, maybe I'm missing something. Then will you make progress? Then you will make progress if you keep and establish this awareness and keep it up happily. What about this work that you can't avoid having to do? Meaning your you know, family employment obligations. We'll also make progress with that, says Ubekin. Yes, lay disciples. One doesn't only get the results of this noble work, but much more. What I say is what the Buddha preached. I'm not adding anything. Now, you are all people of great effort, aren't you? But I just wanted to warn you. What I just mentioned about being too busy can happen at times. When you get some holidays, you decide to come here and meditate for a few days. Then you have to go back to work and don't get time off anymore. You don't come back. Does this happen sometimes? It does happen. Then you abandon the meditation, don't you? Don't abandon it. Carry on with this awareness and at the same time do your work. Then you get two in one go. Then you get two in one, you get two. If you postpone being aware to your hours of leisure, you get only one benefit. You're not fulfilling aspirations which are ordinary, are you? You can attain to the highest and noblest bliss. Now, what are these aspirations you're going to fulfill? There are the different forms of buddhi. Buddhi means the penetrating understanding of the Four Noble Truths, meaning the existence or reality of dukkha, its cause, the existence or reality of its cessation, and the path to the cessation. If you establish effort, saying that you want to get it, you can fulfill all your different aspirations for buddhi right now. This is not ordinary. And how are you going to fulfill them? Each type of buddhi has to be fulfilled on its own way. Sama sambuddhi as sama sambuddhi, pacheka buddhi as pacheka buddhi. So the awakening or enlightenment of enlightenment and awakening of various types, it's really of different levels in a sense, or paths even. Only if we understand in this way do we understand correctly. It's like planting a mature seed when it rains, a plant springs up. Here this plant is nursed well, and when you go back, it's deep-rooted and strong. Is it possible to explain how good this period, this time is? It's so easy now, lay disciples. How is it? Is this a time when one is oppressed by worries and has to groan and moan? No, sir. Is it a time when we can only stare resignedly? No, sir. It is a time in which we can be happy and blissful immediately and never get enough of this joy. You get even more than you wanted. You get even more than you aspired for, don't you, disciple? Yes, sir. You better not disagree with that. So, okay. Well, I don't know. Maybe I'm just a worm, but I don't know how. It doesn't look like a time. I mean, I don't see. I've seen a lot of people in a lot of sanghas, and that I don't see anybody who's happy and blissful immediately and never get enough of that joy for real. I see a lot of spiritual bypassing that where people want to appear to others to be that way or to appear to themselves to be that way, happy and blissful immediately and never changing. I mean, I just don't get it. He wasn't that way. So I don't understand. Oh, yes, you never get tired, not in the present and not in the remainder of samsara. What are the teachings of the Buddha? There's nothing, lots of exclamation marks here. There's nothing that causes stress and misery in the teachings. Of course. Is there? There isn't. It is pure happiness. Exclamation mark, double, double. But the mind may get confused with many thoughts. And I don't think that these thoughts are very pertinent. Right. That's his view. And that's exactly why he says, and he's right, and it doesn't always apply. He's right, and it doesn't always apply. He said, the mind may get confused with many thoughts, and I don't think these thoughts are very pertinent. Right? But sometimes the person can't move forward. Most of the time, most people are not attaining Arahant, you know, even these Burmese. Now, if you're determined to establish this practice, then I don't think that thoughts of doubt will remain at the back of your mind. But they do, for many. Can you not be successful in this way? The mind will think what it wills. Let it. Follow the teachings. Do you understand? Just do it. When you arrive at the goal, you'll probably find that it isn't the way you expected it to be. Does this happen to people? It happened many times, sir. Yes, it will happen. Dear lay disciples, I'm telling you only a little. Those amongst you who work hard will think, this monk is reluctant to tell us all. He's probably very unwilling to part with his knowledge. Everybody laughs in the text here. Actually, I don't think that at all. He's not a closed-hand teacher at all. You will think this is much greater than he said. When you strive for real happiness and because of this arrive at the goal, then you experience something that you cannot describe with words. When you decide, I'll strive so that I'll know for myself, then don't procrastinate. Don't delay. Do you hear? This is so high. It is so good, lay disciples. Work hard. Do you understand? You are all people of great effort, aren't you? Ubagin says, almost all are, sir. Right. They're not all people of great effort. He doesn't want to give people basis for excuses. He doesn't want to give any justification for procrastination. He doesn't want people to procrastinate. He doesn't want people to delay. He doesn't want people to be harmed. He doesn't want people to die and go become a hungry ghost or go to the hell realm or reincarnate indefinitely with a lot more dukkha. He doesn't want that. But he's saying, this is so high. It is so good. Work hard. What's wrong with that? But when he says, you are all people of great effort, aren't you? Ubakin says, almost all are, sir. Yes, good, good. Work hard, won't you? You see, when you yourselves arrive at the goal, and for many of you, even before that time, you can give this happiness to others. You'll never feel reluctant to give. You will want to give a great deal of it, a great deal. This is true, sir. In the course we're conducting now, there are 3 or 4 students who, after about 3 days of being here, cry with great sobs because they regret not having come here earlier. Yes, it's like that. And so, yes, of course. I mean, this was, Anapanasati was the only way I had to get out of terrible suffering in my late teens, early 20s. It really works. It really works. And it's a supremely beautiful, beneficial practice, Anapanasati. And the teachings of Buddha Dhamma are supremely valuable. Absolutely, without a doubt. So it goes on. Ubakin says, they think I should have come earlier. And Weibo Sayadaw says, yes, that happens. Work hard in order to attain the highest. This is the perfect place. Meaning, I mean, he was presenting this probably in Rangoon at the meditation center when they had invited him. And he's saying, you know, what do you need? You what else do you need? You got what you need right here. Just practice. And that's true. And Ubakin says, it's a place to which you gave your blessings, Venerable Sayadaw. And Weibo Sayadaw says, this is a nucleus. It is the first center of many. Do you hear me? May this happiness spread slowly out from this place. Yes, yes, you must work hard. Strive diligently. Working means that you must meditate, and then at times you want to take rest. Does this also happen to you? It doesn't, sir. It doesn't. And Ubakin, who kicked kicked ass as well, says, if the students start to meditate at 12:30, they come out of their meditation cells only at 5 p.m. That's it. That's Burmese Theravada. At the beginning, they do take breaks, but after 2 or 3 days, they don't come out for breaks anymore. So that's what I'm saying. Very strict and very, very one-pointed Burmese Theravadan sanghas, or at least in a retreat. Yes, you see, it's like that. The highest bliss cannot be described in words, but the mind is like a magician. Though one may be meditating here like this, calmly, negative thoughts may arise. Quote, oh, it's so tiring to meditate. How can I achieve anything? I cannot do it. Isn't that so? It's just as you say, sir. They do think in that way. Yes, says Weibo Sayadaw, your mind may be cheating you, but after having established right effort, there's no cheating yourself. Or is it still possible? No, sir, it isn't. Only before you really know can you cheat yourself. Meaning when you really know, you won't be cheating yourself anymore. Yes, sir. And the final line of the chapter is the final line of this book, The Essential Practice. And he said, even so, you may be saying to yourself that you're meditating too long, ... So, now take a rest. So he said, okay, take it easy, you know. So after he said, work, 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 don't rest, work, 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 he said, take a rest. So, yeah, actually, you do need to take a rest. So, all right. It's very different than Changsu, very different than Nisargadatta, very different than Ramana Maharshi, very different than Linchi, very different than Nityananda. He's got his own thing. He's got his own way. Practice first, practice centered, effort centered, Iddhipada focused. And the reality of Iddhipada is that they are crucial to final attainment. And so there's, as I said before on the Wikipedia page on Iddhipada, Iddhi as Siddhi or power, and Pada as base or basis, powers of base, bases of spiritual power. Bhikkhus who've neglected the four Iddhipada have neglected the whole noble path leading to complete destruction of suffering. Those who have undertaken the four Iddhipada have undertaken the noble path leading to the destruction of suffering. So there's no development of on the path. There's no seven chakra development. There's no deep healing. There's no balance. There's no realization of unity, love, one, without undertaking and eventually perfecting, but at least let us undertake the Iddhipada. And again, first we've got Chanda, Virya, Chitta, and Vimamsa. Chanda is this intention or purpose, and it's very much a matter of focused or diffuse. The more focused, the faster we may progress. But then there's Virya, which is, this Wikipedia says, effort or energy or will. I would say will, willpower. And one can have strong willpower, but confused intention. Or diffuse, let's just say diffuse intention. There's focus and focused and diffuse. Diffusion or focus in chanda, in intention. What do you want? Well, I want to go to the right and I want to go to the left. Fine, cool. You ain't going nowhere then, right? Well, I go to the right, but I feel guilty because I want to go to the left. Then I go to the left and I feel bad because I actually wanted to go to the right. Okay, well, maybe you shouldn't go anywhere until you can resolve what's best to do next. And so the focus in focusing attention by knowing yourself, being honest, is number one. By that, then, one needs sufficient energy or willpower, virya, to do the work of seeking to accomplish. And also, one needs a certain clarity or brightness of citta, of mind field, the heart-mind field, the mind state, the personal mind state, the condition of the sky, to be able to keep working towards your goal. And then there's investigation or discrimination, which is to make sure that actually supports this focusing of intention and sustained willpower, and understands the different states of citta that arise, or when we're in the right way, when we're not. By investigation, we may know that. And so citta, and I'll just say a word here and then conclude the Weibo Sayadaw reading or discussion, the whole series. Citta as one of three terms used to refer in the Nikaya, the Buddhist texts, to refer to mind. Others are manas and vijnana, and you know, Vijnana, subjective consciousness, or consciousness subjective, as the fifth of the skandhas. Citta just really, they call it heart-mind, but I'm not sure about that. It's not intellectual, logical. It's basically this sort of the quality of one's mind, of the personal mind. And it can be emotionally driven. It could be clear and peaceful. It could be distracted. It could be, you know, so it can be it can be colored by emotionalism or not. It could be clear and peaceful and calm or not, tranquil or agitated, contracted or expanded, well or unwell. It seems that in Buddhism the word citta is just used as a to explain the quality, the overall quality of one's consciousness. Not the fact of consciousness, but the quality. Not that there is the sky. This is, you could say, vijnana, illuminated by, you know, chit in the awareness. So it all gets, if you, here's where it gets into difficulty when you try to combine Advaita Vedanta view with the Buddhist view using some of the same words, Sanskrit words like chit or citta, that are used with different meanings in the two traditions. So there's satchit in Advaita Vedanta as sort of the awareness of reality beyond personal, beyond subjective and separative. And then there's citta in Pali or in Buddha Dhamma Buddhism, which is more like the quality of vijnana, the quality of personal subjective consciousness. But it's not quite the same as buddhi, which is a function of some of what happens in the sky of mind, the personal mind, called discernment, discriminative awareness, or wisdom discerning, buddhi, versus manas, which is the logical, you know, analytical thought form producing function. So these are all qualities of light reflecting upon itself, which we call mind. So it's interesting, but the analysis of mind is a very useful study as well. So that will conclude the long series presenting Weibo Sayadaw. And let me just see where we are time-wise. Okay, just a couple of comments. Weibo Sayadaw is an arhan, without a doubt. Critical figure in Burmese Theravada in that before there was a Goenka, before there was Ubakin, there's Weibo Sayadaw and Ledi Sayadaw. There were real arahans in the Burmese forests. And they're the fountainhead of modern Burmese Theravada. Burmese Theravada is follows this type of approach, which is it's very ascetic, actually. I mean, they put people in the meditation room or cell at 12:30, and they don't come out till 5. Okay, so you either go crazy, or you have a terrible time, or you have strong breakthrough with that approach. You either run away crying, or you have a psychotic break, or you have a miserable time. You go straight into your hell mind. A hell mind comes up, and or breakthroughs and attainments happen. So it's an interesting approach. And so this whole discussion of Weibo Sayadaw is all about go straight, don't wait, make effort, you can do it, it's doable, and what else do you want anyway? And despite my, you know, qualifications of the suitability of such a teaching for people like us, people who are not who won't go to a retreat where they put you in the cell meditation room for 4.5 hours and say, see you at five. At least I wouldn't do that now. Who really don't want it enough, and we are mired in distractions, but we're mired or interested in other things too. We don't have the sense of urgency. And so there's some of us who are well and don't have, generally pretty well, and don't have that urgency. There are others who are not well at all and also don't have the urgency. The key is if you're not well, please try to get yourself well. And you ought to find some urgency to become more well if you're really in strong angst and emotional distress. But it's also possible to get one's mind to a place of relative well-being that's stable by Dhamma, by, doing good and of cultivating the good and avoiding the harmful and generosity and kindness and honesty and acceptance and practice, and not feel such urgency to sit in a cell for 4.5 hours, which would be great also. And I respect those people a lot, frankly. But I don't feel the urgency. And I don't think there's any problem with that at all. Because one can, one can live in the Dhamma going 65 miles an hour as well as 95. Or one can take a gentler approach, take the gentle path through the valley rather than the sharp ascent. Both are fine. In any case, Webu Sayadaw is a special teacher in this way. He basically said there's no reason to cut a circular path up the mountain, going round and round, spiraling up slowly. Just go straight up, and that's Burmese Theravada. You don't need to take 6 hours going around the mountain, slowly ascending in a spiral. You can take 6 hours or less, maybe, doing tactical rock climbing straight up. And it's very effortful, actually. But it's all about Virya and Iddhipada in general. And so, in some ways, he's a teacher of Iddhipada as well as a teacher of Anapanasati. So, I hope that was useful. That will conclude the series. Next week, I don't know. I may start a series on Dhammapada or not. The other class will be Apollonius for a while because it's a very interesting study. There's some talk about conspiracy. There's some very serious thing going on with Apollonius, I have to say. As I get into it, I see, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. And so that'll go on for months. If the YouTube channel persists. And if you're still here, please bookmark the other pages because particularly the talk on Apollonius is going to dry is going to get some heat. Even though nobody really listens to this channel, just a few hundred people, that's good. But psychically it's going to generate some heat because that's a very serious matter. The story of Apollonius of Tyana and the issue of historicity. But anyway, I hope this has been useful. Please understand that the YouTube channel will be gone at some point, or I won't be uploading. It'll be blocked, possibly, or not. I hope you're well. Take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.